everybody. Thank you very much for inviting me to this interesting meeting. Today I'm the last speaker, and the privilege is when you are the last speaker, you can summarize everything what was already said. I will talk with you about the importance, and I think it's really important for us as pediatricians, because it highlights our importance for long-term prevention. And the concept of the first 1,000 days underlies this. And we have now a clear definition what the first 1,000 days means. So when we speak about the first 1,000 day, we mean that is the golden interval from the conception to the age of 2 years. And in this period, there are some opportunities, but also some risk. And we today will speak more about the postnatal period. We will not speak so much about the intrauterine influence, what is also very important with regard to the long-term consequences. What is also important, you can see here, Hillary Clinton is not a pediatrician. We know her from the politics. But you see that the concept has been also reached the politicians. And this was a presentation on the international conference when Hillary highlighted also the importance of the first 1,000 day by saying it's during the period of the first 1,000 days from the onset of pregnancy to the end of the second year of life. And here it's that nutrition plays the most important role in the life of a human being. So all what we recommend in this sensitive period has a long-term impact. And that is really, in my opinion, that's really something new also, in my opinion, as a pediatrician, because we were not aware of the fact that what we are doing within the first year of life, we will see 10 years, 20 years, 30 years later. So that's why it's important that we develop our equipment, let's say, within the first 2 years of life. So that means, again, during pregnancy. Pregnancy is a very sensitive period, but it would be continued during the first 2 years of life after birth. And it's also a commitment what the first 1,000 days has to give, because here you see an quote from the WHO saying, with the intervention during the first 1,000 day, we could save many of the 3.5 million children who die from chronic hunger or disease. In our part of the world, it's not a chronic hunger. In our part of the world, it's much more dying from disease, non-communicable disease, like high blood pressure, obesity, and so on. If we think about this interaction between the genes and the environment, we can look at the animal kingdom. And it's very interesting, because we always thought that we completely depend on our genes. But our genes is only a small part. They are important, but we cannot blame them for everything what is developed later on. So the gene activity, the genetic activity can be modified, long-term modified, through environmental factors. And you have maybe seen it on the different conferences. These are the American crocodiles. And it's very interesting that the gender of the crocodile is not defined by the genes. The gender of the crocodile is defined by the environmental factors. That means that it's defined by the temperature the eggs are exposed to. If the temperature is below 30 degrees, all offsprings will become female. If the temperature is 2 degrees higher, only 2 degrees higher, all crocodiles will become males. So that means the gender is clearly defined by environmental factor. This is regulated in the nature, because when you have a lot of eggs lying around, then the temperature is different, and so it's a balance finally between female and males. Concerning nutrition, The most exciting example we have from the animal kingdom are the bees, because it's how to become a queen within the bees. It only depends on the nutrition within the first 72 hours. So you have 72 hours, depending on what you will receive as a food, to become a queen or to be a working bee. So it depends really, and that's just the interesting thing. What is happening? Why? It depends that you are fed with the royal jelly. So you need the royal jelly. What is the difference between a normal jelly and a royal jelly? It's the modification in the genes because of the higher potential of the normal jelly to methylate, so to interact with the genes and to methylate some sequences in the gene, and this will change your phenotype. So it's a great example how nutrition can have a deep and long-term impact. As I said, we not all depend on the gene. Gene is, if we compare it like a computer, the gene is only the hardware. But you could never work only with hardware. You would need something what programs your hardware, what programs your genes. And this we are calling epigenetic. So we have now clearly understood that the epigenetic is responsible for the fact that you switch on or you switch off some genes, some sequences in the genome. And that is a very interesting phenomenon. And if we more and more understand it, then we can discuss the chance for prevention of disease, but also risk, because if you can program something, you can also program it in the wrong way. So it's all about, you know, a biochemical system. This is the DNA, this is what we get from our parents, but this is, we are not completely depending on this, we are much more depending on the interaction between the genes with the environment, and here you see food, folic acid, the vitamin B groups plays an important role in the methylation of the DNA sequences, and with the methyl groups, and then you can switch off or switch on specific sequences in the DNA. And this is what we all understand now under the terminology epigene, epigenetic and programming. An exciting example from the animal kingdom again. This is a mice model. Maybe you have heard about this. This is the such-called agouti mouse. Agouti mouse. She is called because of the fact that this mice and the DNA is an agouti gene. The agouti gene is also a gene what we find in human beings. And the agouti gene is linked to obesity, for example. And what you see here is they are completely different. But they are genetically completely identical. What makes them different? The nutrition of this mice, and not of the mice directly, but of the mother of this mice during pregnancy. They received a food what was low in vitamins, especially in vitamin B and folic acid. And with this way, this mice was not able to methylate the agouti gene. And when the agouti gene is not methylated, then the mice becomes obese, just because of nutrition during pregnancy. But this mice becomes obese, they have a blonde skin, what is not a problem, but obesity is maybe a problem, and they have also a higher risk for cancer. And it's only because of the feeding during pregnancy. When you feed these mice now with a normal food, high in vitamin B, high in folic acid, then the agouti gene is methylated, and the offspring of these mice will appear this way. So this shows how important nutrition during sensitive period is for the long-term development of this animal. And this is the summary of this first 1,000-day concept before I give you two examples from the practical life. Is this highlights the importance of our profession. Because what we are doing in the early life has long-term consequences. This we have to discuss with the politicians, where they have to invest the money. They have to invest much more money in the prevention in the early childhood. Because here you see the long-term impact we have. All what we are doing here, timely intervention in the early life, has a long-term impact in the risk reduction of non-communicable disease. This is typical when we are getting older and we are starting now a little bit high pressure, high blood pressure, cholesterol is too high, we go to a doctor, we get some intervention, but the effect is very small. We can also reduce a little bit the risk, but the effect is much smaller. That's why we are as pediatricians also important for the health of a population. Two practical examples that have already been discussed during the meeting. So I cannot add maybe something new, but maybe some give a different perspective of the two ways. You have heard about obesity. And this is now new. We always thought obesity is a problem of the later childhood, of my age. Yeah, we should move more, we should not watch so much TV, we should not play so much computer. But now we have really to understand that obesity prevention starts during pregnancy, during the intrauterine life, and within the first 2 years of life. You have seen the potential for risk reduction in this sensitive period is very high. And it's the same true for atopic dermatitis. We can only prevent from atopic dermatitis in the early childhood. We can never prevent the primary prevention in later life. The link for both disease, it's a little bit now sophisticated, but the link is the protein. We have more and more to understand and to learn about protein quality. It's not only the quantity. It's really something about the quality. We have seen it today that, for example, the protein, okay, contains amino acids, and some of them, and that's why the influence on weight gain depends on the amino acid profile. So in the future, it's not only a question of lowering the protein, it's much more a question to put the right quality in. You need the protein profile with amino acid profile, what is lower, for example, in the insulinogenic amino acids. So insulinogenic, that means amino acids that stimulate the release of insulin. On the other hand, so this is the profile, and this is the structure. You know, it's not a linear structure, it's a very complex structure. The acid sequencing and the 3D structure, this will have an impact on the immune reaction. This is why some of us react with a cow's milk allergy, because of the sequence in the 3D structure, the 3D structure within the protein. Can we change this? You have seen it today. I only summarize now some key aspects. Atopic dermatitis depends on the genetic background. We have a much higher risk when we have a genetic background. That was discussed today. And every third baby is affected. This is across Europe, across the world. It's a little bit lower in Africa, in Asia, but across the industrialized world, around every third baby has a higher risk because it's born in a family where already allergy is existing. And we have an opportunity to prevent because we cannot change the genetic background, but we can change the feeding. So we can recommend to the babies breastfeeding, as you have heard today. When breastfeeding is not possible, to use a proven hydrolysate, but only a proven one. Finally, and this is a very new information because I read it only yesterday, even the regulatory body have acknowledged that we need a new regulation for the HA proteins because we know that the current definition for HA protein is not appropriate because you cannot be sure that the protein what is in an HA formula will have an effect. And you have seen this from the Cheney study. I took this as a great example. 4 months, maximum 6 months feeding period. And you even see an effect 10 years later. This is exciting. That we have 10 years later, we can even see a reduction in the atopic dermatitis, but only with both formulas, not with this HA formula. So there was HA formula used in the Cheney study where we have never seen any effects. That's why we are now discussing the change in the regulatory environment. And I took another example from the Cheney. This is the combination of the intervention study with the non-intervention group. And this is very exciting because it shows the interaction between genetic and nutrition. I mean, the lowest risk, and actually we should recommend to the babies, search the right parents. But it's not possible. You cannot look before which parents you get. Because it would be great if you are born in a family without a family background, without parents that having allergies. When you are a baby without a genetic background and you are fully breastfed, you have the lowest risk to develop an atopic dermatitis within the 6 years of life. It's not a zero risk, but it's the lowest risk. When you have not the right parents, and you get now a genetic background, but you are still fully breastfed, your risk is higher because it's driven by the genetics. So this we can maybe not influence. But now comes something what we can really influence. But you can still be in the bad position that you have the wrong parents. But now you maybe have never heard about allergy prevention. And you take a normal infant formula based on intact protein. What is the result? You increase your risk only because of the feeding now. Genetic we cannot influence. Feeding behaviors? Yes, we can. First of all, we can recommend breastfeeding again because then we reduce the risk to this level. Or we recommend a proven hypoallergenic formula because with the hypoallergenic formulas, it's not better. But you can compensate, let's say. You have a risk reduction. You significantly reduce this one. And you can compensate for the twofold risk of children with a positive family history. So this we can influence. Again, we cannot influence genetic. But with our recommendation, 4 to 6 months feeding, 10 years results, we can influence the development of atopic dermatitis. Obesity you have seen, this is now the amino acid profile what plays a role. This was the expected number of obesity in Europe. This was based on calculation. These are the real trends. And you have seen this also in the presentation before. Obesity is defined by the WHO as the greatest epidemiological problem in the future. And that's why we have to react. And when we are very honest to ourselves, the best thing is prevention. Because for today or until now, we don't have a good treatment. Yeah? So we need to focus on the prevention. And it's a pediatrician who should start with the prevention. Because 77% of overweight children are obese in adulthood. So the problem starts in the early infancy, and then that causes all these problems, what you have seen before. What are the mechanisms discussed within this obesity problem and nutrition and programming effect? I will not talk about the gut microbiota. This is also a very exciting field. You can really see in obese people, the microbiota is completely different in comparison to normal one. The question is, we don't know what came first, what was first, the change in the microbiota or that's a result of the obesity, but it's very exciting. The postnatal, let's say here, the fetal overfeeding, this is what is the intrauterine life. When you have diabetes during pregnancy. For example, when you have overweight, women become pregnant. The risk for the baby to become obese later on is three times higher because of this intrauterine exposure. The mismatch hypothesis, this is a very interesting thing, that your intrauterine, you have undernutrition, and postnatal, you have overnutrition. And this we know from this SGA, small for gestational age babies. I'm not talking about the preterm now. I'm talking about healthy, but small for gestational age babies. They have later on a higher risk for obesity. They are small at the beginning, but they end up when they are 20, 25, they have a much higher risk to become obese. And one of the facts is this overnutrition in the early infancy. Postnatal diet, overfeeding, excessive protein intake, you have heard about this. So if we speak about obesity, we can ask ourselves, is this transgenerational? Because it's the influence of the mother, the intrauterine programming, because there is too much fuel around. Yeah, you get too much nutrition in the intrauterine life. And then the postnatal programming, when you grow fast, but maybe you pay later. You have seen this protein hypothesis has been confirmed in all studies, not only in animal studies. This has been also confirmed in all the studies that has been performed with human beings, with babies, that you, with the high protein intake, you have a higher amount of insulin-releasing amino acids. This stimulates the insulin. You have a higher early weight gain, and you have a higher adipogenic activity. So this has been confirmed in all the studies. This is an animal study I got from a colleague in Berlin. Very interesting. This was, you see, mice, an overfeeding. So that you can do in the mice model, you take out some offsprings, and then the rest of the mice get an overfeeding. The overfeeding was only for 10 days postnatal life, only 10 days. Then you put the rest of the mice in again, and you have a balanced feeding again. What you can see, the mice that was overfed during 10 days of life, here it's the age of 210 days, they become obese. They have a higher risk to develop obesity only because of a 10 days overfeeding. And they have, when you measure now the blood pressure, the fat composition, you really see a metabolic syndrome. And only because overfeeding within the first 10 days of life. This is also an exciting study. It's an old one, but it shows also the problem. Also animal study, and here you see when you put the animals and a dietary restriction in the early life during a sensitive period where the hormone system, all the system is still developing, they have long life, a lower weight gain, only because the dietary restriction for 3 weeks, but in the early life. When you do the same thing, but later, and it means in the life of a mice, here are all systems fully developed. It's not anymore a sensitive period. This is what we have, somebody of us maybe have experienced. When you go to a diet, you reduce weight, but finally you have this such called rebound. You end up even with a higher weight. Again, that shows that the time point of intervention is important. Long-term results we will get only in the early infancy. And again, the good thing is we have so easy things to recommend. It costs nothing. Breastfeeding. Breastfeed your babies. Here you see the meta-analysis you have seen in the previous slides, some results, but here you see a meta-analysis with the different effects, and this is huge. When we think about a 20-30% effect here, but in average we have a 25% risk reduction for a population, that's a huge impact. And it costs, again, nothing. We have to be aware of the fact the size of the effectiveness of breastfeeding depends clearly on the duration. So the longer the breastfeeding period, the greater the impact is. But they have also baby food after 6 months, so it's not exclusive, yeah? But here you have a breastfeeding period 6 to 9 months and you see the highest impact of breastfeeding. This is a study from Germany, because one of the reasons is why breastfeeding is protective, because the protein content is low. The quality and the protein content, and here you see the average intake of a baby when it's fully breastfed, it's not one, you see here the percentiles, and here you see when you put it on an infant formula. When you put it in a normal infant formula, the protein supply is 80% higher. That they get 80% more protein, what is not necessary. What now we know with the protein hypothesis may stimulate a higher weight gain. And that's just a little bit of problem we are facing today. The formulas, and you have seen it in the previous presentation, are too high in protein. We cannot go to the same level because the quality we cannot really mimic, 100% mimic the quality of breast milk. But in the long term, we have to change our infant formula systems. We have to reduce the protein content. And this has an impact. You have seen this in this presentation or in this result in the previous presentation. I only show it again. This is the SHOP study. This is the 6-year result. And what was the exciting point is, this is the medium, the 15th percentile, and here you see still it's a significant difference, but when the baby starts with a higher BMI, the impact of a high protein diet is even higher. You see, this is an obesity rebound, and this spoke about the programming effect. Here you see really the result of programming effect, because you get an obesity rebound after the age of 3 years of life, only because you were exposed to a higher protein diet in the early life. And the risk, finally, is 2.5-fold higher to become obese at the age of 6 years of life. So the clear message is today, and this is the recommendation now also from the scientific societies, from the ESPGHAN, from some publications, when you look in the international literature, is really to recommend, if breastfeeding is not possible, an infant formula with the lowest protein content. Because this is the start in the right appropriate weight gain. And we should watch the growth curve. Because this is the risk group. You know, when a baby starts even high, and the growth curve is this way, the risk is not really increased. But when you have a percentile crossing growth, that they really start to grow up this way, then you can anticipate, here starts the programming. They will, even when you reduce this again, maybe long term, they will have an impact. So that's why we should watch the growth curve, and when it really goes this way, we should interfere, we should intervene, we should discuss with the parents. The only thing where we don't intervene today is when this baby is fully breastfed. You can also have such a curve where you have a fully breastfed baby. I call it every time the breastfeeding Buddhas. Yeah, fully breastfed, but and we know today what is the difference. A fully breastfed baby, the growth curve of a fully breastfed baby is very often so high, but it goes down. Whereas when you have this growth curve based on a bottle feeding, then it starts high and it will continue high. So we will not see the same rebound as we see in a fully breastfed baby. That's why when we see such a curve, we should intervene. To summarize, the first 1,000 days are really important. I hope I could underline this. We build our protection for the next 25,000 days. You know, we are getting older. The prognosis is the way that every year we add 0.2 months of a higher life expectation, what is very high. But we need to start to prepare our long life from the beginning. And if you only look at the two aspects we have now discussed, for healthy growth, the first recommendation, breastfeeding. If breastfeeding is not possible, then the protection against increased risk of obesity through high protein quality and low protein content, the recommendation is 1.8. If you look on the allergy, and it's mainly on atopic dermatitis, it's not asthma, but it's atopic dermatitis, again, breastfeeding. When breastfeeding is not possible, we should use a clinical proven hydrolysate to protect the baby long term. Together, and this is my last slide, because it's really a call to action, because we cannot blame the industry, we cannot blame the family, we cannot blame the doctors, we can only work together. Together with the family, with the industry, and with you as doctors, together we're nurturing a healthier generation. Thank you very much.